Welcome to the fourth meeting of the Pentland Hills Regional Park Boundary Bill of 2015. Everyone present is asked to switch off mobile phones and other electronic equipment as they affect the broadcasting system. Some committee members may consult tablets during the meeting. This is because we provide meeting papers in digital format. Our first agenda item today is to agree to consider our draft report in private at subsequent meetings. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. Our only item of business today, therefore, is evidence on the Pentland Hills Regional Park Boundary Bill, and I welcome Dr Aileen, Minister for Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform, who is supported by Helen Jones, Head and Ellen Huis, Policy Officer of Landscaping Involvement with the Natural Environment Branch, Scottish Government. Thank you. I'd like to start off by asking the Minister what the benefits are of the existing Pentland Hills Regional Park and whether she considers these would be enhanced by extending the current boundary.
I'm happy to do that, convener, but I don't know whether we're...
Would you like to have a short opening statement? My apologies.
I'm quite happy to put that on the record. Thank you very much, convener, and good morning. I have obviously been following the work of the committee on consideration of this bill very carefully, and we welcome this morning's opportunity to set out the government's view. Now, whilst the government recognises the geographical reasoning behind wishing to extend the southern boundary of the Pentland Hills Regional Park, I would like to briefly just explain why the Scottish Government has concerns about supporting the bill at this time. There are two fundamental reasons. First of all, regional parks are a matter for local authorities, not the Scottish Government. Given the practical impact that such a designation could have in terms of local authority priorities, my view is that decisions on regional park boundaries, funding and management should continue to be made at a local level. As Minister, you'll obviously appreciate that it would be inappropriate for me to intervene in what is properly a local authority matter. Now, local authorities already have the powers needed to extend the boundaries of the regional park if they so wished. However, it has become apparent from evidence provided to the committee that the five local authorities are not aware of a demand to extend the park and do not support the bill, especially given current budgetary pressures. Now, I am also particularly conscious of the fact that the two councils most affected are not seeking a boundary extension. Indeed, Scottish Borders Council is strongly opposed to it, and I understand from their evidence that the pressure for outdoor recreation in their area is simply not in the southern Pentlands, it is elsewhere. And secondly, convener, I have concerns about the procedures that are set out in the bill. The Scottish Government's memorandum explains that the bill represents a shift away from all the existing safeguards that are set out in the Countryside Scotland Act 1967 and subsequent regulations. Now, those provisions provide a framework, procedures and process for consultation which need to be properly considered. Convener, your committee has heard from a range of witnesses that they have concerns about the proposed boundary extension, and because of this and the reasons that I have just set out, the Scottish Government is not able to support the bill at this time, and I look forward to answering your questions.
Thank you very much, Minister, and I'm sure some of the points that you raised will be there'll be questions asked in more detail about it. Can I go back then to the question that I asked beforehand about whether you consider the Pentland Hills Regional Park would be enhanced by extending the current boundary?
Well, the committee has obviously already heard from the Pentland Hills Regional Park manager about the visitor management services provided in the park over the last 27 years. Now, the benefits include catering for the visiting public through such things as access points, footpaths, rights of way, signage, visitor centres and advice about, you know, where to go and how to enjoy the hills responsibly. Another benefit is about aiming to balance the provision services to assist visitors to enjoy the hills responsibly with managing the landscape and the impact on existing land uses. Now, whether these would be enhanced by extending the boundary would depend, you know, very much on the level of buy-in from the local authorities involved, and obviously three of the councils, West Lothian, South Lanarkshire and Scottish Borders, have already told the committee that the area covered by a boundary extension would be peripheral in terms of their population centres and recreational demand.
Okay, And further to that, can I ask, do you consider that the existing governance arrangements are working well?
To be honest, Convener, this is not really for me to judge. I mean, I think, you know, the Scottish Government, you know, is not involved in the governance arrangements of regional parks, and that is actually, that's how it should be. You know, the members of the Pentland Hill Parks Joint Committee, I think, are best placed to judge that. And I am aware that the park manager told the committee that the park is managed as an integrated area across local authority boundaries, and that they make a pretty good job of managing it as a whole.
My last question to you at this stage is whether you are aware of any demand to extend the existing regional park.
No, I'm not aware, and I think also all the witnesses have also said that they're not aware of any demand either.
Okay, thank you. Alec, you have a few questions.
Thank you, Convener.
Good morning, Minister and officials. The member in charge of the bill has quite rightly said that the bill, if passed, would simply draw a line on the map, delineating an area of extension that she believes is desirable. Her reasoning for that is that by drawing that line on the map, you would galvanise the then five local authorities that would be involved to work together to make it happen, basically. Regardless of the funding concerns that you've highlighted already. And it's quite clear that all the local authorities, even the ones that were not against the principle of extending the park, had real concerns if there was no funding increase from somewhere to make it happen. Do you think that simply putting a new line on a map, if you like, would have that desired effect of pushing local authorities to work closer together, particularly when they appear to be fairly against the extension in the first place?
I mean, I certainly believe that, you know, I think drawing a line on a map would, you know, it would create expectations about, you know, how the park would be managed and funded. And I think, you know, as the members quite rightly pointed out, you know, we've already heard the local authorities and also the National Farmers Union for Scotland and Scottish Land and Estates are all concerned about this, and obviously the committee has heard about the budgets of the local authorities, that they are already stretched and that there is no flexibility within them. They have explained that it would have to divert scarce resource to an area that is a low priority for them. But in terms of pushing the local authorities to work together, I mean, that's really a matter for them themselves.
I think what you're saying is that even if this bill were passed, the Scottish Government would have no remit over it, how it was all taken forward. Yeah. Given that, this question may be irrelevant, but I mean, have you any idea or any estimate of what additional resources might be required if this was to go ahead?
I mean, I'm pretty clear that the relevant local authorities, you know, they are best placed to consider this. We know, as I say, all five local authorities, and you know, from what I've seen from the evidence that they've submitted, they have made it quite clear that the resources are already pretty stretched.
Okay, thanks, Minister.
Can I just come in on that one then? And by creating the regional park, were additional resources allocated to that area when it originally became a regional park, and then would the expectation be that somewhere additional resources would have to be found if it was extended?
I think we have to remember that local authorities, you know, they take the lead, you know, on regional parks, and, you know, they were intended as local authority, you know, funded and managed organisations. But I think at that point I might bring in Helen Jones.
Is this a reference to when the park was set up in the first place?
Yeah.
Well, Convener, that was 27 years ago. I'm afraid my memory doesn't stretch that far back.
Would that bring expectations which would bring funding priorities with it?
Well, at that time, of course, there were two tiers of authorities. It was Lothian Regional Council that set the park up, and that's why the boundaries are as they are. And at that time, Lothian Regional Council must have made resources available. I mean, I can go back and try and check if there are records, but I'm sorry, I can't confirm precisely what their decision was, but it must have been done.
No, I appreciate that. Mm. All I was trying to get to was if there is additional resources required because it becomes a regional park, therefore if there was an extension, the same thing would apply the extended area.
It would, yes. Scottish Borders and South Lanarkshire would have to dip into their pockets.
Thank you very much. Mike?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister.
We've heard, obviously, from the five local authorities affected that they're concerned about the additional budgetary pressures and so on. And that's the kind of downside of this equation, that they're shrinking from the prospect of more challenges on their budgets and a call for greater expenditure. That's the downside of this equation. The upside is potential benefits, perhaps, in terms of health, recreational benefits. Do you feel that there are tangible benefits to be derived from extending the boundaries of the regional park as being proposed?
Given that the committee has already heard that there is no evidence of demand for an extension, it's quite difficult to make a case for health benefits. I mean, statutory access rights already apply to the Southern Pentland Hills. People can already take access there and derive health and wellbeing benefits if they so wish. In addition, the fact that the extension is quite remote and it's away from the big centres of population. So, I think West Lothian Council, they've also described it as the remotest part of West Lothian.
Okay, Dave.
Thank you. Good morning, Minister and officials. You would have gathered from our previous evidence sessions that consultation for those living in the proposed park area is a factor. And notwithstanding the Minister's earlier comments that the government is not supportive of the bill, what's the Minister's view on consultation? Should those in the new area of the park be consulted as set out in the Countryside Scotland Act and the subsequent Regional Park Scotland Regulations 1981?
Yes, absolutely. I think this is very important. I don't think that we should dispose, with the carefully thought through procedures and the consultation arrangements that are provided, already by the current legislation.
Okay. My final question, again, notwithstanding the Minister's earlier view about the government not being in favour of this bill, assuming this did go ahead, would the Minister consider conducting a feasibility study prior to legislating for an extension? This is probably more a philosophical point in light of the Minister's earlier comments.
Like the local authorities and obviously the NFUS and Scottish Land and Estates, they have said that before the bill is taken any further, obviously a feasibility study should be carried out to properly assess the demand for boundary changes and the impact of extending the boundary. Now, if the local authorities did want to extend the park, then it would be for them to agree on conducting a feasibility study. In terms of the Scottish Government providing that funding, well, as I say, no, because as I say, if it's local authorities that wanted a feasibility to assess the demand and impact of extending the boundaries of the regional park, then they would have to initiate and fund this themselves.
The Minister, of course, won't be aware of what happened when Lothian Region set the original park up, but perhaps Helen Jones, when she's doing her research, could find out whether there was a feasibility study at that stage, because that would be quite useful, I think, for the committee. Yeah. Thank you, Convener.
Yeah, we're more than happy to come back to the committee on that point.
Thanks.
Thank you, Minister. Mike? Convener. We heard from some of the objectors that they had concerns that increasing the extension to the regional park would have the potential to increase bureaucracy and increase the hurdles within the planning system. Do you have any comments to make on that?
I think so far as planning is concerned, I mean, local authorities would obviously be expected to follow the guidance in Scottish planning policy, which states that, and I quote, the proposals that affect regional and country parks, they must have regard to their statutory purpose of providing recreational access to the countryside close to centres of population, and they should take account of their wider objectives as set out in their management plans and strategies. So any proposal for development would be considered on its merits in the context of the planning system itself.
Okay, thank you very much, Minister. That is our evidence session over with you. I want to thank you for your time and your succinct answers. And we will suspend the meeting for a short intermission. Do we change what this is? Thank you. Okay, we'll now recommence our session. And I'd like to welcome the member in charge of the bill, Christine Grahame, MSP, who's supported by Diane Barr, Non-Government Bills Unit, and Neil Ross, Solicitor in the Scottish Parliament. Christine, would you like to make a short statement?
Thank you very much, Convener. And I want to thank, first of all the witnesses and all those who responded to the consultation and those who give evidence. So first I start with what's the purpose of the bill. It's simply to extend the current Pentland Hills Regional Park to include the whole of the Pentland Hills range. Nothing more than that. So you see, much of the evidence, in my view, that's been led in respect of this bill is addressing a bill which is not the bill before you, which was not drafted. That bill would have contained sections about management, funding for wardens and so on, none of which is relevant to the terms of the purpose of this bill. My bill simply draws, as we keep saying, a line on the map. What is a regional park? The statutory definition is, quotes, an extensive area of land, part of which is devoted to the recreational needs of the public, Countryside Scotland Act 1981, section 48A1. It's quite distinct from a national park and all that goes with that. And I would think you would agree that the Pentland Hill range fits that definition. So why is it necessary to do so? First, there is an obvious argument that if you're defining in legislation something as the Pentland Hills Regional Park, it should encompass the entire range, not 45% of it. And that's what my bill sets out to do. So why bother apart from that pedantry? Green space is important, particularly green space situated next to urban areas. The access rights and responsibilities under the Land Reform Scotland Act 2003 and the Scottish Outdoor Access Code have widened access to countryside and increased recreational opportunities, not always accompanied by proper use by the public. This has led to increased pressure on green space, and if we're serious about retaining this for future generations, it needs to be protected and increasing demand managed. Putting the whole of the Pentland Hills range on a statutory footing can provide that protection. As you know, it's been 3 decades since the Pentland Hills Regional Park was created. I don't think we should wait another 3 decades to understand its importance. So what does it do, the bill? It extends a southern boundary of the Pentland Hills Regional Park back to that line on the map. What it doesn't do, it doesn't change public access rights. It doesn't place additional planning restrictions on landowners or farmers. It doesn't place additional government's conditions on local authorities. And it doesn't place any financial obligations on local authorities other than those detailed in the financial memorandum. And the bill provides for this to happen in one of 2 ways, either by Scottish ministers making regulations to alter the southern boundary outlined in the bill, or to alter it in line with an alternative proposal agreed by 5 local authorities. A 2-year period is provided to enable the 5 local authorities to consult and agree on a new southern boundary. And that period is also useful to agree how the regional park will be managed, to investigate funding options. And that's a welcome byproduct, but it's not a requirement of the bill. As you know, the bill has already acted as a catalyst for taking a fresh look at governance and funding arrangements. This is just the beginning, and I very much hope that these discussions continue, although these are tangential. Finally, Convener, I welcome the committee's scrutiny of the bill and thank you for the opportunity to provide evidence today, and I'm very happy to take questions.
Thank you very much for that, Christine. You've said what the bill doesn't do, but can you explain for me, in practical terms, what benefits will come from extending the park?
I think that the first thing is it cures rights a wrong, because the original intention when the park was first set up was it would include the entire range. So that's the first thing, it rights a wrong. And the benefits are that it gives an opportunity, not just to local authorities, but to other interested bodies, to set up a new management scheme, only an opportunity, that's all. There's no obligation, but it gives them that opportunity. And it also, of course, the benefits to the public are, as we see the green space around our cities and villages and communities shrinking with house building and developments, more and more pressure, and I'm asking you to look 30 years ahead, not just next week, next year. The pressures will build up over that time on these. It will open up an opportunity to offer protection to the hills. Now, I know that they already have some kind of opportunity in areas of special scenic value, but that doesn't have... All of the councils have said that, the five councils adjacent to the proposed extended park, but that doesn't offer any kind of real protection to them. This would give the opportunity to offer more real protection.
But you've told us it's just a line in the map.
It is just a line in the map. I keep saying it offers the opportunity. That's all I'm saying. It offers the opportunity. For example, the current management of the hills in the north is under pressure. We know that. My concern, and I think it's a concern shared by many, is that the support that's given to that part will diminish, perhaps to de minimis over time. And that by doing this and giving a two-year period, though I'm happy to consider a longer period, but not 3 decades, by giving a two-year period after royal assent, as I propose, for the bill then to come into force, it gives not just local authorities but other interested parties an opportunity to look at the management that they have, look at levering other funding in. It's not the purpose, but it's certainly a welcome, consequence if that happened.
A number of questions from my colleagues, but can I just ask, your responses to me suggest that, as has been mentioned by others, that there will be a rise in expectation if the park is extended to the area that's now going to be in a park. Would you agree with that?
I think what we're seeing in any event, I mean, I do not support the view that suddenly, when this bill comes into force, there'll be sort of mass exodus from cities to use the recreational assets of the Pentland Hills. And it's already happening. It's already extending to quad bikes and horse riding and so on all parts of the hill. And I don't think the public are necessarily aware when they move, I'm sure they're not, from one part of the park, which is designated a regional park, to another. So I don't foresee that. There may be a little, but nothing like, I think, the fear factor that's been put, that suddenly, people will depart from Edinburgh and Glasgow and whatever and pile themselves into Pentland Hills. Not at all.
Thank you. Alec?
Rita, thank you. Good morning, Christine.
Good morning
to your to officials. Could I ask a slightly more general question based on something the Minister said before I move on to the area I want to ask about specifically? When the Minister gave his evidence, she made it quite clear that previous regional parks, and indeed regional parks still are, the sole preserve of local authority. In the past, when they've been set up, the demand has come from the local authority, the structure has been agreed by the local authority, the funding has come from the local authority. Why should we, as a parliament, suddenly decide that we should dictate the boundaries of a regional park? Rather than the local authority.
We're not actually dictating because...
Yeah, we are dictating the boundaries if we pass this bill.
No, you're not actually. Forgive me, committee member, the fact that there's a default position that after a period of 2 years, if the five local authorities have not come forward with other proposals for it, then those would be the boundaries. But the local authorities, while not under an obligation to do this, have an opportunity within that 2 years collectively to come to view with where those boundaries are. But they've got to be within the area I've got with the roads. They've got to be within that, and they must contain three of the major hills. But we're not dictating. I certainly would hope that local authorities, it's not mandatory, but they would come to an agreement about where those boundaries should be. Unfortunately, my concern is that unless I have a fallback position in this bill, they won't do it. And besides, it's primary legislation. There's a duty on the member to have surety in legislation proposed, and the surety I have is here is the position: if the local authorities do nothing, there's an alternative that if they do something, they can determine specific boundaries within the roads I've designated. So it's not in any way mandated. I'm not in any way commanding local authorities. In fact, I'm do hoping they'll be cooperative.
Thank you for your answer, but while you quite rightly say this is about drawing a line on a map, it would seem to me that it's a bit of a thin line when it comes to whom we're passing the responsibility. And I hope also that I hope the member in charge would agree that while this is about drawing a line on a map, this committee would have been remiss not to have looked into the potential consequences of that in our scrutiny and the questions that we've been asking. One of which concerns the Section 8 of the Countryside Scotland Act 1981, which, as I'm sure the member is aware, inserts Section 48A into the Countryside Scotland Act 1967. And what that states, and she would hear me asking about this last week, where a planning application is made in relation to lands which fall within an area designated as a regional park, the planning authority shall have regard to the fact that the area has been so designated in considering the application. Now, I would fully accept that the responses we got when witnesses last week were questioned about that were not exactly black and white on the impact. I wonder what her view is on what that actually means when it comes to a planning application from within a regional park.
The words, of course, we must focus on shall have regard to. And if we look at the precedent of how they deal with area of great landscape value, which they have regard to, is that each local authority has interpreted that differently. And that is a non-statutory designation in areas of great landscape value. With regard to planning applications, as you quite rightly say, when challenged, witnesses could not give any examples where there was any distinction between planning restrictions by various local authorities on the Pentland Hills throughout. And yourself will know from your background, on farms, for example, they're quite tough about farmers wanting to build a bungalow on it for retirement. That's through all of it. And this will not impact on it. It may give some protection to, let's say, wind farm development. It may, but it's a may. It's not a must.
I generally accept that, absolutely. We have asked for some clarification from one witness who said they were aware that it had some impact. But I think I would take it from the fact that that is written in to the legislation. Have regard to the fact is not going to make it any easier to get planning permission, even if it doesn't make it harder. Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much. In written evidence, Scottish Borders Council argued that the extended area of the park is already protected by numerous designations, including special areas of conservation, sites of specific scientific interest, additional environment. What do you think these mean in practice?
Well, I think I've just expanded to some extent on that. I think the concern is that people think when something is designated an area of great landscape value, which Scottish Borders Council, along with the other four councils, do, it actually doesn't mean an awful lot at the end of the day, as each council can do. It doesn't give protection to those areas. It's not guaranteed protection against development. Neither would I add particularly is a regional park. But I think that making something a regional park will not only councils, as I say, have to have regard to it, but perhaps also the public will be aware that there is this asset on their doorstep and they will have regard. And there's no better, as I say, critique of planning consent, and you'll know this from your own entry, than the public at large. So though it doesn't, it's not like a national park which has huge planning restrictions, as we know, I do hope, and it's a hope, and I hope over the years it will mean that we watch what we're doing with the Pentland Hills. I mean, we had the witness from Balerno who explained at that end how the pressures are impinging there to build at that end. So, you know, while it doesn't make it mandatory, I hope it will, the bit have regard to will come to have some purpose to over the decades. And I keep repeating over the decades, because my concern throughout this thing with this, the matter with this bill, is we've sat here for 30 years and pretty well, and many people weren't aware there was a part of a regional park in the Pentlands. We've also taken it to granted for a bit. I don't think we can continue to do that.
But you say that these designations don't really protect, but they make people aware that they're there to some extent, and therefore that might make the place more attractive to be about. Would that not then raise expectation if the same thing applies to the regional park? We go back to this expectation all the time, that you'd get more visitors there and then there would have to be more facilities to look after.
I think I've dealt with that. I really don't see an explosion of people. I mean, remember, this is deferred for 2 years, so it's not enforced for 2 years. It'd be interesting to see if this bill were to get through stage three and the Parliament agreed to, we've got a 2-year deferral, whether, because the public often think that when a bill's passed in Parliament, it's enforced. It'd be interesting to see what would happen in those 2 years. I suspect there might be a sort of interest at the beginning and then it might just peter away and we'd have, I hope, more people visiting, but visiting more responsibly. But I don't think we're going to have sort of an exodus of people from the cities to the Pentland Hills.
Thank you, Alan.
Can I
have
a supplementary?
Yes, of course.
I'm sorry, before I again move on to the specific area I want to just briefly ask about. I think you'll have heard me say before that I think inevitably, if this bill did pass at stage three, there would be a headline in the papers, Pentland's National Park, Pentland's Regional Park extension agreed, and a large area showing exactly where that extension had agreed. And you said yourself, and I think you're absolutely right, there would be an initial explosion, might be too strong a word, but initial increase of interest from members of the public as to what this was about. And they're going to go out there and they're going to find absolutely nothing has changed from what it was the day before. But we come back to this business of expectation, and the fact that expectation leads to increased interest leads to pressure, pressure needs to lead for resource, and it's quite clear there is none. And I really do think that is a flaw that would, even if the thing carried through in the way you would hope it would, and eventually the local authorities agreed to come together and fund the extension, it would inevitably have been damaged in the meantime. And I just wonder what your thoughts on that are.
Well, I think we must already look that we passed legislation that gave the public, well, if we put it in common parlance, the right to roam. You know, and there are obligations and duties already on the public. The existing legislation will still prevail.
To interrupt, the public does not have a right to roam.
No,
there is
a right of responsible access. I was coming to that.
There is a big difference.
I said in common parlance, it's known as the right to roam. It's not my language for it, but that's
be.
How the public think about it. And the point I'm making is that there are duties upon the public. And I couldn't, as I said to the farmers that were before you last week, I'm on their side. My position is the last thing I support on this planet is people recklessly using the countryside and thinking, I'm entitled to run, I'm entitled to walk here, didn't you talk to me like that kind of thing? And that's absolutely opposed to that. And I've seen too much of that. And obviously when I was going into this bill, I went about the Pentland Hills and saw the issues that were arising, particularly where access was quite easy and car parking. So absolutely, but these restrictions, quite rightly, will remain, and I would want them to remain. And perhaps, can I flip the coin to the other side and say, by saying, if this were to pass, the Pentland Hills Regional Park is now extended to the entire range, we then open up the whole debate about how we use the countryside that's on our doorstep, in particular on our doorstep, responsibly. It's about time. So, you know, I take your argument that you think that suddenly people might, but I think I see it as an opportunity to say, yeah, that might be the case. The fact is it's not for 2 years. But while we're at it, you don't just take your dog and let it run about. You know, you don't just do this, you don't do that. These are working hills. And the main custodians of the hills are the farmers that work them. I know that. So it gives you that opportunity.
Yeah, all of which comes as part of the Countryside Access Code anyway.
Of course it
so
does.
It's there. I think there's a strong case to be said that the right of responsible access came about as a result of public demand. Where's the public demand for the increase in the Pentland Regional Park?
I'd tweak the word demand into support. There's huge support. And of the responses to my bill...
I was asking about demand, not
support.
Well,
51%,
it's different.
51% were in favour of my bill, who responded to the consultation. So, you know, apart from the statistics of 51%, but it's enough. 51% were in favour. I think there's a great deal of support for this happening. So, you know, the word demand, how often do we have things about demand from the public? You get support from the public about proposals that are put forward. I didn't pick this out of the blue. You know, I didn't just suddenly say, what can I do a bill about? People came to me and said, Christine, I'd like you to look at the issue of the Pentland Regional Park that doesn't cover 100%, you know, about what's happening on it and so on. It's not been touched for 30 years. That's how good it is. So if you're like, I can get demand at knocking at my door to have a look at this. And then having put out the proposals and having met people in advance of the legislation being drafted, I met with friends of the Pentlands who don't all agree. Many of them do. I've met with ramblers. I've met with organisations. And of course, as I say, 51% responded in favour of the bill. So I think I prefer the word support rather than demand. People don't usually demand legislation, but they support it.
I still think there's a significant difference between demand and support, but we'll maybe leave that to one side just now. In terms of environmental and landscape benefit, what are your thoughts on how your proposals would bring benefit in those two areas?
Well, of course, what will be at the end of the day, if I may repeat that line on the map, is drawn, will be what was there the day before. Nothing will have changed. There'll be no more additional developments, there'll be no more change to the hills, nothing will have changed. But what I, and I'm probably going to repeat myself again, is what I hope will happen, but it's not part of the bill, is that over the period of 2, perhaps 3 years, depending, I'm happy to tweak, that not just local authorities, but other organisations look at how these assets are properly maintained. And the thing that's important here is the farmers will be part of that, which they're not at the moment. So far as maintaining their own paths and their own fences and so on, yes. But in the northern part, the farmers are part of the consultative forum and the landowners are part of it and the walkers and the ramblers, all the people who treasure and use it are part of this. So while it's not in the bill, over the period of years when they can look at this, they will be they're in a team together. They've got the same views about what they want to happen to the hills. They're not in conflict with each other. And they know what's to the benefit of the farmers and the benefit of the landowners is to the benefit of responsible users of the hills. So that would come. It's not part of it, but in that period of time. And if we don't do that, in the bill comes forth, nothing will have changed about what a responsible right to access the countryside is. Nothing will have changed in that sense. So it's neutral, or better than neutral, it's highly positive, and it takes things forward in respecting, and especially the green space on our doorstep.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Balerno Community Council objected to the bill on the basis that the proposed extended park doesn't include areas to the fields to the southeast and west of the Balerno village boundary. Can I ask in what way that area is distinct from those areas included in the revised park boundary in the bill?
Well, can I say, first of all, congratulate Richard Henderson on his evidence, because he turned out to be very positive about my proposal, notwithstanding the fact that Balerno was not forming part. And I think a huge sympathy is for Balerno, the huge pressures there. But if you look at it coldly, Balerno does not naturally form part of the Pentland Hills. And while the Green Belt is coming under pressure, that's not part of what I was looking at. I was looking at what one would see as the Pentland Hills range, because that's largely an urban settlement. It was also rejected by the majority of respondents on that basis. So, you know, I think there are problems for Balerno, but I think they're a matter for City of Edinburgh Council in terms of their planning policy and Green Belt. But it really didn't, in sort of parlance, common parlance, fit into the range of the hills. And I hope Balerno accepts that, because I do have sympathy towards the difficulties they have.
OK, thank you for that answer. Mike?
Thank you, convener. A number of witnesses expressed concerns about safety. The one witness had concerns that increased number of visitors would be perhaps subject to safety concerns, like getting lost in the fog due to the nature of the topography in that part of the park that's currently excluded from it and which the bill proposes to encompass. And one of the farmers expressed concerns in terms of the differing nature of farming in that southern part of the park. There are more cattle, as I understand it, in fields there and so on, and that gave rise to a safety concern on his part. Do you feel that, given these concerns that have been expressed, that some kind of safety assessment should be made of the proposals? And if so, whose responsibility would it be to carry out that safety assessment?
Well, I have to say to Mr. McKenzie that, as I said, in fact, to Alec Ferguson, I see this, if the bill were to go through, as a refreshing course, a refreshment course for the public in knowing how, yes, they think, and I say this again in inverted commas, Mr. Ferguson, they think they've got a right to roam, but in fact, what they have is a right of access, of responsibility, and to know how to not only impinge on the farmer's livelihood in the way that they may distress animals by the way they're behaving or be reckless or ignorant of what they're doing, but also to realise you can't go into a field of cows just willy-nilly. They can rally around you and go for you. And I've been there once upon a time, my ignorant days, my teenage days. You know, they have to know what they're dealing with. Now, you know, if you're in a town, you know how to look left and right before crossing the road, and you've got safety rules about that. In the same way, when you're using the hills responsibly, you know which paths you should be on. I know some farmers already indicate the paths that people will take and show them how to do it. And that, you know, they should know that you don't go across into fields of a certain kind. So that's the issue. It will raise all these things. So I really don't subscribe to the idea that you know, the additional safety issues will occur on the hills. You know, you have some personal responsibility for what you're doing in life. Don't go out in thick fog walking on the hills. If you get a weather warning, there's going to be thick fog. Don't set out if you don't know what you're doing. So I think that issue is there. But the other issues about safety, where animals or equipment or whatever is involved, is a matter of back to looking at the Act, which gives people the right to access the countryside responsibly. And I see this as an actually positive thing in the bill. I mean, I have to say, nobody paid any attention to the Pentland Hills Regional Park since I raised this. And now people are beginning to pay attention and say, so we've got a regional park, and it's kicked off a whole discussion about how we use those hills and use them responsibly. So I see this as a positive, not a negative. But then I'm an optimist in life, Mr. McKenzie.
I mean, I welcome, you know, the discussion that's surrounded the bill. I think that is a positive thing. That's a good thing that we give those issues an airing and that this has provided a forum for it. But I think the point the witnesses were making is that by drawing attention to the park which is currently excluded and saying this is now within the boundary of the park, that would give rise to greater numbers of people visiting that part of the park, and that in turn would give rise to greater safety concerns and potential incidents. And I find it difficult to, you know, to argue against that. And given the fact that the public can on occasion be quite silly, I mean, there was a report last week during this, I don't know if it was a hurricane or a typhoon, but this storm Abigail, that a man apparently went to the top of Ben Nevis. And you can understand, therefore, where safety concerns arise if we're actively encouraging people into the countryside. And I assume that it's at least part of the intent to encourage...
But Ben Nevis in a hurricane, you get what you deserve if you're blown off. But, I mean, there are certain things I can't protect the daft folk from. I want to make a point about safety in regard to the current park. I don't know of any particular issues that have arisen of... I mean, there have been tragic cases of particularly young men swimming in reservoirs which are freezing cold, despite fences saying do not swim in here. There have been incidents of that. That is the only thing in my personal recollection I can say that has been a safety issue in that respect. I do know there are issues, very different issues, about sheep being worried by people letting their dogs off the leash. That's of concern because that's happening in places where the farmer cannot monitor it. That's happening across the Pentland Hills, whether you're in the regional park or you're not in the regional park. So there are more safety issues to livestock, frankly, than there are to individuals. They're not the mountains, they're hills. And as I say, if you'd gone out in a mist and you're not experienced, you're daft. And nobody can legislate for daftness.
Thank you very much. Dave?
Thank you, Convener. Could I give the opportunity to Christine Grahame to put on the record the underlying aspirations and benefits of the bill?
Oh, sorry, I thought that was you. I thought that was you making a statement in favour of it. Well, the benefits, what can I say? And I know you've been here, Mr. Stewart, with your own bill, so you'll appreciate that you get, it becomes your baby. The benefits to all aspects, in my view, are substantial, potentially substantial. Let's take the benefits to those who object, for I fully understand. In due course, if this bill gets, as I say, past stage three and we have a deferral period for it, it gives the opportunity for all the parties who cherish those hills to get their heads together and look at a way of ensuring that all their proper needs are met and respected, whether it's the farmer, whether it's the hill walker, whether it's a casual visitor, whether it's the school party. That's one of the benefits. The other benefit is, I think we've not used them enough, and I know I've talked about pressure, but we've not used them for instance, health purposes. You know, instead of the doctor prescribing pills, perhaps we could prescribe a wee walk in the hills. We've not used them for educational purposes sufficiently. There are so many advantages in there, properly exercised, and I stress properly exercised to Mr. Ferguson, you know, where children can be aware of the wildlife on their doorstep, when they can be made aware of simply where their meat comes from, of what farming really means, of the issues prevailing. I mean, I went recently up on, I have to say happily, on a great big four-wheel drive thing on a farmer's land away up in the middle of nowhere. And apart from the fact that it was wonderful, I realised the difficulty for the farmer, for instance, in preventing rustling, which is actually very common in Scotland, but often the sheep farmer doesn't know till he brings them down from the hill how many have been taken. And this is professional work. There's actually a benefit that if people are walking these hills and see something amiss, they can tell the farmer, because he can't be everywhere at once. So I can see benefits of a huge kind. If you ask me about the disbenefits on the negative, I honestly am at a loss to find them. You know, I think this is an opportunity, not a problem. I think that, and I'm delighted that we've had the negatives put in, because it makes me have to rise to answer them, which I'm hoping I try to do to you. So I cannot see disbenefits. I can see benefits to generations to come. I'm to say to you, Mr. Stewart, in my short lifetime, I have seen green space melting away around wherever I have lived. Now, if that happens in my span, what's going to happen in the next 30, 40 years to come to the green space around it? Now, maybe you're in Galloway or in the Borders or in the Highlands, and it's not so obvious, but it's very obvious when you have a huge conurbation like Edinburgh and extensions down, places like Pennycook that are expanding, that embrace the Pentland Hills. It really is to ensure that we don't just let a creeping urbanisation happen, that's part of it. But also, if we do find that we need more people to access these hills, it's done in a responsible fashion. And hopefully, we will have in place proper warden services and so on. That's not part of the bill, but that's part of my, if you like, vision. If I may use that awful word, vision for what would happen.
That's helpful. My final question is about local authorities. And
yes.
Christine Grahame has obviously sat through our evidence and followed it closely. Now, the five local authorities concerned, Scottish Borders, South Lanarkshire Council, Midlothian, City of Edinburgh and West Lothian, were asked specifically by the convener whether they would support the proposals in the bill without additional funding, and they were all clear, convener, to say no. How would you respond to that as a member in charge? Because rightly or wrongly, funding is crucial to this. So how would the member in charge respond to that evidence?
I can say absolutely. When I saw how the current funding of the current part of the 45% of the regional part was, I was shocked to see how it diminished over the years, and they're leaning very heavily on the City of Edinburgh Council to provide $250,000. That will not continue. But to get back to the bill, I didn't put in my bill management, I didn't put in my bill funding, well aware that these were issues beyond my scope and beyond anything that this could establish, and things that, if they're soluble, they're not soluble by this, by imposing anything on anybody. What I'm doing is giving an opening by that line on the map for a breathing space for people to consider other issues. For example, my bill would only cost, and I'm looking at it, some 7,000. That's all. The other things, like the 20,000 that's mentioned and parking, these are all not costs of the bill. The 20,000 would be the proposed or prospective cost to local authorities should they wish to do a different boundary. The costs of parking, they're not part of the bill. They're put in some kind of fairness to say these things might occur, but they're not part of the bill. And, you know, my concern is, so that's a straight question to what are the costs. That's the cost of this bill to local authorities in Tenby, and there's no cost, of course, to the government. So The other material, I absolutely understand why you went to all the funding costs, and local authorities are seeing this because they think, oh, this is just the beginning. We'll have all these demands put on us. No, no. Everything has to be consensual. The current costing arrangements between the existing three local authorities are by minute of agreement. That's a contract. That's tripartite consent, if you like. So there's no way anything can be imposed on them by this bill. And I wouldn't want it to be like that.
Recall, I think I raised some questions about funding with the local authorities, and if I summarise that convener, basically they were saying their existing budgets are squeezed, and I then asked, could you name or identify some other funding that you could bring to the table? And on memory, I don't think any of the five local authorities could actually provide me with any viable, sustainable, longer-term funding. I mean, I know you can't answer, Christine Graham, for the views of local authorities. But would you accept that it is difficult to identify non-standard or additional funding sources if the part was to be extended?
I had this set. Yes, I've got it here. I've got it. Thank you. I don't expect them. I know. I mean, I've actually said to them in informal meetings. If you've got people in your ward who are needing repairs to their houses or potholes, they're not going to want to put money into a regional park. They want that stuff done. I am very pragmatic as a politician, very realistic. I'm not actually saying to local authorities, dig into your coffers, which will probably be even smaller as time goes on. That's not. That's part of the reason I looked at this. The main reason was to take in 100%, but part of the reason was also to say, in times of recession, where can money come from that's not just directly from taxation? And already what's happened with regard to the northern part of the park is approaches have gone, because I don't see the five local authorities, if they set something up, it's up to them. If they do a management thing, it doesn't have to be them. It must be a whole range of people. If we look at it, we've got the Cairngorm Mountain footpath appeal. We've already had a Cairngorm Outdoor Access Trust. That's the current park has now levered in funding from another trust. So what they were looking at, and I've just sat through their meetings, it's not really something for me to tell them what to do. As far as I know, they don't want to form another trust. They're not thinking about a trust to take over everything. That's quite cumbersome. But what they were considering, and that's just the existing ones, was the three local authorities would, a partnership with other trusts, lever in funding, mainly for capital projects, but some developing revenue to add to the local government funding. So, you know, there are solutions out there, Mr. Stewart, and they're not always to be found in just making local authorities scrape the barrel for more money. There are solutions. We use them, for instance, in other sectors. We use them, for instance, in I chair justice. We use them in justice, the third sector. Volunt provides huge funds to support the justice portfolio. So in the same way, I think there's an opportunity here for other funding to be levered in. And that's part of the reason why I give the 2, possibly 3-year extension period, so that in greater minds than mine can come up with solutions to lever in funding, both capital and provide revenue to maintain the park should it be extended. I think they're going to be doing it in the north anyway, because they can see the way the wind is blowing, but there's no harm in looking at it the south as well. In fact, it would be excellent, because people don't know when they're moving from the existing regional park into something that isn't. They don't know that. Some may, but most people won't. But the facilities that are available under challenge in the northern part, the warden service and everything, are not available in the southern part. And that what I'm looking at is, let's look at it all together and let's look at how we fund it.
Alec, you wanted to come in there?
If I could have a brief supplementary, sort of indirectly, it is a funding issue, but not quite the same one. And my question results from what one or two witnesses have brought to our attention, not least of which was Mr. Henderson, who I think you quite rightly said made a very credible witness last week. And one of the things he said, and I wrote it down at the time, it was on the subject of a feasibility study into this whole issue. And he said, which I noted, if it hasn't happened already, it should have happened. Now, that does require funding. It requires quite a lot of resource to do a proper feasibility study. And I just wonder what your thoughts on that are.
What's happened is SNH has said they would assist towards a feasibility study. And that's the very thing that could take place in the period of the 2 to 3 years, between if the bill is passed in Parliament.
I agree with you entirely. My question, though, is relating to Mr. Henderson's point
yes.
of view. If it hasn't happened, it should have done.
Yes.
In other words, a view that has come from others as well,
yep.
that a feasibility into all of this yep. should take precedence before any alterations are made.
Well, my view is, you won't Clearly be surprised different. Here, is it won't happen if this bill doesn't go through, because people will just sit back. They'll have other priorities on their desk. This will be a little stooshy that's happened. My view is that the Pentland Hills northern parts, funds will diminish and nothing will happen about a feasibility study. I think we've both been here long enough to see feasibility studies a bit of long grass. I don't know how many feasibility studies I've seen in my time in here, but they've lasted a very, very long time, and some of them have delivered nothing. So part of it is that's why this space. Get on with a feasibility study. And I mean, I say about Richard Henderson, he was quite right when he said that this should have happened. And I also got the impression from, he says, that he was very supportive because this might, I'm not wanting, don't really quote him this, but this would push it forward. He saw this as aspirational legislation that would make the agenda move forward. Otherwise, 30 years' time, we'd still be sitting back where we are now.
To be fair, I think he was very keen that the only part of the regional park that he thinks should be extended into is the area surrounding Bologna, which is the one part that isn't. But you've already explained the reasoning behind that, so I'm quite happy to move on, Convener. Okay,
thanks very much. Mike, you've got questions.
Thank you,
Convener. You've already touched on the matter of the existing funding problems, and given the evidence that the committee have heard, and that I'm sure you're aware of, the concerns expressed by the five local authorities, do you consider that it's likely at all that there would be a proposal from those local authorities to extend the park under Section 1 of the bill?
No. No, and I understand why. I mean, I understand their position entirely. I don't think the government would do anything. I don't think the local authorities would do anything. And they're the only parties that could move it forward other than myself, or I wouldn't be doing it. I fully understand why. On their entry, there are far busier things than doing this. But this is enabling legislation. That's all it is. And it's enabling that line on the map to be drawn, that focuses that particular thing. Years can go past, but then we have buffers to hit 2 or 3 years down the line where the local authorities must have taken a view on whether or not they want that to be the boundary. And also it gives all the other organisations, not just local authorities, not the burden just to fall on them, to look at are there better ways of managing the park, the whole park, in providing proper facilities to assist all the users and the people who work the land. That's what that's about. But no, they won't do anything. And if this falls, I can assure you, nothing will happen with the local authorities. They'll just say, thank goodness. And I think they'll be very wrong, because in doing that, they'll have missed an opportunity to find other ways. And they'll still have levies. The existing ones will still have levies on them to put money into the northern part, which they can, and certainly the City of Edinburgh, can ill afford.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's the end of the evidence session. I'd like to thank the witnesses for their time and their replies. The next meeting
could
of
I,
the committee...
Can I possibly just say a final thing with your leave, Convener? A very brief thing.
I'm not sure I believe that, Christine.
It will indeed be brief. You see, it occurs to me that if the current defined regional park loses all its funding, it still remains a regional park, which really makes the case that the funding issue is a separate, very important, but separate issue from the designation. And I have to say that I don't basically understand how we can call the Pentland Hills Regional Park that, where it isn't the entire Pentland Hills range. That's thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. That was short indeed. Thank you. The next meeting of the committee will be on Thursday, 10th of December 2015, when we will consider a draft report on the bill. Could I ask the other committee members to stay behind for 5 minutes after? I now close the meeting. Thank you.